Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to today's event. I'm Jason Gumbert from MSDynamicsWorld.com. I'm pleased to welcome everyone to today's session all about integrating EDI with Dynamics 365 for finance and operations. And as we get started, just a couple of notes. First, we do have a very busy and full hour for you, so please do plan to pay close attention, and we also welcome your questions. You can enter them into the questions block you should see at any time throughout the event, and our presenters will be taking those at the end. So without any further delay, I'd like to let things get started here, and I'm going to hand things off to Jerry Kaus for to start things off.
Yes, thank you, Jason, and thank you all for attending this webcast. From to increase, and we are going to introduce you to our solution for EDI and the different scenarios that you could use it, and we will also demonstrate the solution in Dynamics 365, so you get a complete overview of our solutions. And the presenters today are myself, Jerry, I'm the left one on the pictures, and together with Eric on the right one. And I will do the introductions, and Eric will show you the solutions. So we are from to increase, and we are an independent software vendor already for 14 years, actually, in the Microsoft ecosystem, with over 170 people just creating software solutions, with a customer base of 2,200 customers all over the world using one or more of our solutions. And we sell through a very active channel of partners, Microsoft partners, in Dynamics 365 and FO and Business Central. This webcast for today is focused on finance and operations. And here you see our complete overview of solutions that we have available on finance and operations. But we will focus today on two of them that together create an EDI solution within Dynamics 365 F&O, being Connectivity Studio and EDI Studio. And I will tell you later what these solutions do in a total solution. We have a small agenda where I will introduce the EDI scenarios that we see in the market and that customers have a choice to take in their specific situation. And after that, I want to introduce the two solutions that I just mentioned. And after that, Eric will demo you these solutions in a view from a business user perspective in Dynamics 365, and also how the technical side works. And after that, I will summarize it, and we come to the questions that you could have and can enter into the questions box. If we are not able to answer all questions, we will pick it up, of course, later after the session. But I hope we can have some questions for you from you. So if we look to EDI solutions in the markets that are available, and we look and what would a customer ideally wish for, then we see two types of stakeholders within a company that wants to go to an EDI solution. And that's very easy. You have the business users, like the salespeople or purchase or logistic people. And at the other side, we have the IT department that has a stake here in an EDI solution. Business users ideally like to have all information around orders, purchase or sales or logistics processes at hand, easy accessible and maintainable. And that might mean that they want their information integrated with all other information. So it would be nice if in ERP, all information around EDI documents and processes are integrated. So they can take good and fast decisions and have one single point of truth. That also means you need integrated functionality. Have one flexible system that covers all the needs within a few clicks, instead of being in multiple systems maybe to find all your information. It would be nice to have it all integrated and visible. On the other hand, IT people ideally like, of course, happy business users. So they need to create what makes business users happy. And that business users are made self-sufficient in handling a lot of the issues that might be there in EDI communication. So they can handle data issues themselves, for example. So the IT people can focus on other nice technical challenges. And IT people like to have easy, flexible, and configurable tools and potentially multi-purpose tools, so they can do more with it than only one thing, so they can handle new business needs with speed and quality. And above that, on top of that, they want to be flexible in choosing as much as possible their suppliers based on business demands, technology, and cost. So with this in mind, we create our EDI solution, which is flexible and can still be set up in different ways and in different scenarios. What are the different scenarios that we see? Well, number one is direct EDI integrations from the ERP to customers or suppliers and logistic service providers, and create direct integrations. But of course, there are multiple customers, there are multiple suppliers, and maybe multiple logistic service providers. So this also means a lot of integrations that you need all to maintain from within the ERP system. So this means that a lot of maintenance or a lot of setup and a lot of knowledge is needed on the ERP side to set this up, a lot of communication with these customers and suppliers to set it up. They all want it a little different. So a lot of work. Maybe for some integrations, this is great when it are heavy integrations with loads of data going back and forward. Maybe a direct integration would be ideal. But what we see more and more is, of course, having a broker or a van in between, where you have one data or one message flow with all the data you need, so the broker can split them and match them with the needs that the customers and suppliers have in the different formats that they would like to have and send. And what I already said, maybe there is also a direct integration preferred. So in that way, you have actually a hybrid into EDI integration, where you can do direct and can do the indirect messages. But then you need to be flexible on several parts in integration and have the knowledge for that and the tools. So there is also a 2.0 version of that scenario, where brokers or vans, or let me put it different, there are customers and suppliers that want to do EDI. But the question is, how many of your customers and suppliers want that? And also, how big of part of your total business is through EDI? What we see in a lot of cases is that EDI is just a small part of the total business. And it is always a discussion on, is the business case okay to set up EDI? So there is maybe a lot to gain also in non-EDI communication and digitalize that. So a lot of brokers and vans also focus on receiving and sending other types of communication, like email with an PDF or an Excel in it. So customers that are not able to talk EDI, but maybe can send email messages with the order in it, where the broker can translate that into the same data connection already existing. So the ERP gets almost all order and other document exchange through the same channel. And that is really a digital transformation. So where brokers or vans can not only receive email or other type of communication, but also have a web portal, for example, where customers can put in their orders, or where suppliers can get their orders, put their invoices, and in that way the ERP gets it all in the same way, and the business users can handle all orders in the same way. So that is what we see more and more now, and want to promote. So if you look then to the specific integration between broker and Dynamics 365, we see two types of brokers there, where they have their own integration, their own connector to the several ERP systems, but in this case Dynamics 365, and you have them that do not have that and need to make another type of integration. The ones that have it, created connectors either through the data management framework or through OData, and all the needed order info or invoice info goes through that channel, and probably also some master data, so they can do the validations on this side in the platform they have to the messaging. You could also handle all validations in Dynamics 365 when you use the to increase solutions, Connectivity Studio and EDI Studio, and enable the business users to view incoming orders together with all the data in ERP, instead of the need to go to another system to look at issues, but have the issues in Dynamics 365. And all validations are already set up during implementation. So that's in general what the options are here, the scenarios. So the question is, where do you want to do validations? How does that need to be maintained and set up? How are changes done in connectors or in validations? And how about upgrades? Of course, we have upgrades of Dynamics 365. EDI Studio and Connectivity Studio are in the monthly upgrade scenario. So, and as EDI and Connectivity Studio are quite external entities, so they go easily with upgrades. But also the connectors sometimes need updates, upgrades if things are changed on the Dynamics 365 side, or you as a customer have specific wishes, or the customer of your customer has specific wishes. So always pluses and minuses on all sides. What we have done with our solutions, we have created in Dynamics 365 or AX 2012 for that matter, we have the same solutions. We do not use the standard integration tools of Microsoft, so not data migration framework or OData or something else. Already since AX4, we have a solution called Connectivity Studio, which is a platform to make integrations based on configuration. The whole mapping and all is done by, and the whole setup is done by configuration. Where with the standard Microsoft tooling, we talk a lot about developing integrations. And you can do messaging in a lot of formats, and you determine how the structure is. And we deliver a lot of templates with Connectivity Studio to make integrations, including EDI messages. And it's also used for data migration. On top of Connectivity Studio, we have two solutions that are business user focused. So that add functionality in Dynamics 365 to handle data coming in and going out. And especially handling data or orders that did go wrong, that have data issues like a wrong date or a wrong article number. You want salespeople to handle that themselves. So we added functionality to do that. And also the whole setup, like which customers want which messages, because they maybe don't want an invoice through EDI, but they want them on paper or whatever. So for every customer and supplier, you can set it up specifically to their needs. And we we deliver templates to make integrations, for example, with brokers. So we want to make it easy to manage the whole integration yourself, be flexible with which broker you want to connect. So you could also connect to a broker today, and if prices are not good enough and you want to switch to another one, you could tell them, these are my XML messages, you adopt them and we move on. So it's also a sort of decoupling point from between ERP and the broker. And you can set up with Connectivity Studio the integration with suppliers and customers directly as well. So creating the hybrid situation. And that leads me to my colleague, Eric, who will take over now and present you how EDI Studio works for a business user.
Thank you very much, Jerry.
You're welcome.
EDI Studio. How does it work for a business user? Now, for that, I will do a demonstration in the system. And what I will demonstrate are some of the following typical EDI processes. So, and this is more order related. Like Jerry mentioned, we also have a warehouse for doing EDI traffic to 3PL warehouses or do third-party logistics. These are the most common or some of the common EDI order processes where you see purchase orders being sent out or maybe sales orders be received by a customer, those kind of elements. And what I want to show you in my demonstration are, for one, how can we get an import in our system and how can we do the necessary validations, of course, and how we set that up. And also how you can see what a process within Dynamics will lead to a nice sales confirmation that we can send out to the customer, that we say, okay, you ask us these and these amounts and we will can deliver in this way, maybe the same delivery date, maybe different delivery date. And of course, other messages can be configured. Now, how will the sales order process look like? We have two processes actually for our sales order inbound. We have a process where we will pick up the message, and it can indeed be coming from a vendor, we get that message in and we will go not to staging. We will get the document and we import it directly into a sales in the sales table, so in a sales order in Dynamics 365. Or what we can do is, we pick that file up that we're getting or that information. Could it also be via an API. And we first import it into a journal area, a sales order journal area that was created inside EDI Studio. And that area, in this journal, we accept any information. So even if it's incorrect information, but we accept any information. So if, for instance, the item number is wrong, then we still accept that. We do, however, validate it to the existing data in AX and then see what we can do next. If all is validated, there will be another message run and the sales table will be created. This all, of course, all these messages that I'm running, that I'm talking about, can be done in the background. So that could be background messages where the user, the salesperson, will not see that at all happening. He will just have his screen showing, okay, there's something wrong with an order. And that's something that I will show you now. So I have here my Dynamics 365 screen. And this is that sales staging area where you see a lot of messages already processed. This is an area where a salesperson could examine if something goes wrong. And I can hit refresh and nothing is there yet. But I'm receiving a sales order. And that sales order is now present on a file storage, but maybe that is coming in via FTP or other origins, and then it will be processed. Now in this case, it can be processed, and let's see that it can process. Yeah, now it's processed, so that could be a system picking up a batch process that will pick up that order. And if I minimize this and hit a refresh, then you see a new message or a new actually order being created in my staging area. However, that journal status is rejected. So the system already captured your problems. If it was okay and if it was approved, immediately a sales order can be created, of course. But in this case, it's now in a waiting area, in that staging area where a salesperson can take a look to examine what's going on. And this is all inside Dynamics 365. So a salesperson can regularly take a look at this, maybe get an alert from Dynamics 365 because it's in Dynamics, so we can send out alerts, or we can of course add information to a workspace where you can have a tile showing you that there are some errors. Now let's take a look at that sales order that we got in and why it's wrong. I have the button in the top, validation errors. So that's something that the salesperson can take, press to see, okay, what were the problems there? And you see there are two types of problems. There's a delivery date that is in the past. Everybody, of course, wants to have their order delivered yesterday if you really want it. But yeah, of course, not always that will be the case and can be handled. And there's an item not known. So now if you have those two information steps, you can, the salesperson can start solve those. There's some scenarios that you could, that salesperson could take. He could say, I will reject the entire order and give a notification to the sender saying, okay, you need to resend that order because there were errors in there. Or what he could do, he can have a call and have a communication with the customer saying, okay, there were some errors in that order. What should it be? And then he can start solving that in that staging area. So first he goes to the header, and there you see that requested receipt date that was incorrect. So he could, yeah, move it up to today, or maybe change it to, yeah, the 24th. Maybe the customer thought this was the correct receipt date. So he changed that, and that's then the requested one. Of course, still the system needs to, in a later stage when a sales order is created, the real receipt date should be there, but the customer in this case wants to have the 24th of June. So he saves again, he presses validates, and now he takes a look at the validation errors, and you see that that error of the receipt date has been solved, and now only the item error is incorrect, so something to be solved again. So there you can take a look at the lines. And the system will show them in the bottom, okay, there is a rejected line. And the reason was, again, the item number was not known. But still you see that we will accept the original item number. But what we could do is change the item number to the correct number. We can have a communication with the customer saying, okay, what will be the correct item number? And there we can change it. We can even take a look at standard Dynamics data. So because that is of course there, it's an integrated system, so the data is of course available for us. We can select the item number, hit save, and the system will tell you, okay, this is the wiring harness M001 that the customer wanted. Maybe there was just a glitch on the keyboard that it will was wrong. Now, this is now what I select, is an internal item number. But a customer could also communicate, of course, via barcodes. And in a later moment in this demonstration, I will show you how, for instance, a barcode communication will be handled, or maybe an external item number, how you can set it up. In this case, I solved the problem. Still, of course, no the original item number. So and that's in your history. So in the future, if there is a question to the customer, why was this changed to M001? We can still, of course, have that origin number available. So if I now hit validate, then this status is now approved. The order itself is approved. There are no longer validation errors, so I can approve that order. The salesperson in this case is done. He has an approved order in the list. If I hit, it's approved. It still needs to be processed. And that's another batch process that can pick that up. And in a few moments, if I hit refresh, then you see it's now processed. And you see also that an order has been created. Now, of course, always the reference number, the requisition number, if I will open that journal again, you will see here in the header, there's a requisition number. This number, of course, should also be present on your order. So let's take a look at the order that was created. 115 requisition number, remember that. I'm here on the sales order in AX, now created. And in the header, you will see, yes, there's that demo 115 requisition number. So you always have that link, of course. And in the lines, nicely, M001 was created and M003 was created. In the sales order area, you can, of course, go back to the history. And that's the EDI history. When did I receive the sales order? In this case, of course, it was created date and time. You see that was today. So that's something that was handled there in history. So always there is information to see, okay, where did an order come from? When did I send out something, etc. Now, going back to my earlier, what I promised, my earlier promise, how can you set up all those information then in the system? How do you communicate, for instance, via items? That's all done on the customer. So let's open the customer form. And on my customer form, I have another EDI group inside the system where I can specify the setup of a party. So how do we communicate with this customer? This customer communicates with us via this code. That's his unique code to say, okay, I'm communicating all EDI traffic with this barcode number. And we and the system then automatically will transform this number into our internal item number, the US027 number. And there's more setup possible. For instance, maybe you noticed the EDI partner. Sometimes there's EDI messaging required from, if you have, for instance, a retail organization, that the store will activate actually the purchase order that they want. They send it via EDI. However, it still has to come from the holding, and then you can specify what is the holding in this case for this party. And other functionality is that within the system. Then the item. In this case, going to the item, I'm communicating with the standard code, our internal code. But of course, we can also communicate with our customer external item code, or maybe a barcode or a more global barcode, the GTIN code. And that's something that you, of course, can discuss customer by customer how you want to do that. And then the system will automatically translate that barcode or that GTIN code into the correct item number. So that's something that you can specify. Now, what more can I specify? So this is then the unique codes. These codes, by the way, for the question, what more can I specify? These can also be set up on addresses. So if the customer wants the delivery on a specific address, then we can set it up on the address as well, these unique codes. And of course, also on vendors and warehouses, if that is required, if you do 3PL warehousing, or if you want to do EDI messaging through vendors. Now, what more can we set up? Those are the EDI document flows. Here I can specify per customer what EDI traffic do I want to do with him. So do I want to do an order inbound, exactly what we did now, but maybe if I want to send out a confirmation, I want to do that, or a packing slip post or an invoice. This is what you set up. The moment you will then do a confirmation on an order in AX, automatically the system will check if there is an agreement with the customer that you will do EDI with that customer. So automatically the confirmation can be sent out to that customer. Of course, if you are talking about a VEN, then first that file will be sent to the VEN. They will do the translation and send out the confirmation in the correct format. But on the other hand, we also will handle all kinds of different formats. This is the flow, document flows. And that is something in the next topic that I wanted to show you, that when you do a flow or a confirmation, that will look something like this. So I have my process step. I do a confirmation in the system. The system will act on that and will make sure that the file is created and be sent out. So let's take a look in the system again, how that looks like. I will go back to my order. This was the order that I created, demo 115. I will go to the sell tab page. I say I want to confirm my sales order. I press OK and the sales order will be confirmed. The system now will recognize, OK, there is confirmation document flow agreed with the customer on EDI. And what will happen in the background then, that there will be in the outbound message queue a customer confirmation journal created. Outbound message queue, new word, what is this? Well, to keep the speed for the end user, we're not starting to process an order automatically. We will put it in a queue and then the system can via batch process that queue every half hour, every hour, depending on how you want to set it up. So there will be no performance drops then. The moment you do confirmation, also that file will be created. No, it will be entered in a queue, and then the queue can be emptied on your setup. So in this case, I can empty the queue. I will run it manually, but of course, if you want to do it batch in batch, then you can do it like this. But in this case, I'll run it manually, and you see here there's a message being run. Never press run it, then you will see that here my confirmation has been created. It was really quickly, but you see, look at the time, it is just created. And in that confirmation journal, that can be sent then to the customer or to the VEN. And if I open it, you will see nicely in the notepad that there is again somewhere that I hear this, that demo 115 number created. This of course is pretty technical. The end user will not see it, but it will happen all the time in the background for him or her. If I'd refresh, you see nicely this one is now processed. Now the validations, that was also set up because I had validations on items and on delivery date. Now those validations, you can specify that again on your customer. And if you take a look there, you see that there are two validations, just on requested delivery date and on item. So for this customer, I only will check on that. But of course, there are more validations that you can specify in the system. And that's something that I can take a look at here, where I see I have some, for my journal, I have some validations on if the, order already exists, sales ID, delivery date, lines existing, and I have multiple setup validations that you can specify within the system. And this is then on the header. But we also have validations on lines, of course, and this is, for instance, a multiply, if the multiplicity is correct, yes or no. Or maybe if the item is stopped, then I want to know that. And this you can specify per, party, so per customer or vendor. You can also specify this for all the legal entities. So you say, okay, I want to do these validations for everyone. And then you set that you want to have it company-wide, and that's then only one-time setup, and all the customers that are doing EDI messaging will automatically will be validated on what's coming in. We also have messages of what's coming out, so that's why you see the purchase trends and the journal. If you actually, this is not coming out, this is a, if I get a confirmation back from my vendor, first I want to check certain things, and this is something that you can specify as well, and then there's also a staging area for that. Oh, so going back here to my customers, and this was the staging area, and it will of course show only the errors, but here you see that this is the staging area of the inbound process of an order. So for EDI, after my process, some summary of what we're doing. It's integrated in Dynamics 365. So whenever there is a process triggered inside Dynamics, automatically we can activate that. That is something that is within our system. We have the staging areas. We have that for sales orders, for purchase orders, for warehousing, and for all of these staging areas, we have data that we can validate. Process support. Of course, you have many different processes and all the history, what we support. So the order to cash, to procure, to pay, all of those are just standard in the system. And we have a lot of history available. And it says available at hand from the different forms. Like I showed you, you can open the history from a sales order form. You can open the history from a customer to keep track of what happened to an order. Multiple EDI formats. I showed you the XML variant. Of course, we can specify ADFACT and NZX12 as well. But if you do all those formats, why is a VEN important? Well, why the VEN is important? They have a lot of these formats at hand. And what we can set up is the global messages. But if we want to go direct, if we don't have a lot of EDI messages, then we can do that, of course, as well. So, and that's why Jerry said there's this EDI processing 2.0, where some go via VEN, some go direct to your customers, to your vendors. And this is therefore we have those multi EDI formats that we need to have available. And then party setup, how do you want to do item messaging? That's in that party setup for customers. Is it external numbers, barcodes? But also, how do you know where it's coming from? Which is my sender? And then we have to have a nice barcode on addresses, on customers, on vendors. So those were the technical differentiators, but of course we have business differentiators as well. If there's a problem taking for EDI messaging, then we want to make sure that the business users can solve that problem. In older situations in the past, and if there was an error, an item is coming in, we import directly into the sales table, boom, error, item is not existing. Then IT department has to take over. Now, what we can do is with those staging areas, we can the business user can take over and validate the information. Everything is configurable. I will get back to that a little bit later with my Connectivity Studio information, but all the setup that you saw, we can configure. So not only the party setup for barcodes or the items, how they're recognized, but also the messages. All the mapping that we have available is configurable. And I will get back to that later in the demonstration. Jerry mentioned it already. We have our EDI studio. We have a golden message that we can communicate with VENs. If you want to change VENs for any reason, then still we could say this is the golden message. We connect it to the VEN, and the VEN will automatically take care of all the how to communicate with the different customers or vendors. Connectivity Studio or MDM capabilities. If you remember, we had the Connectivity Studio in the bottom. the business head EDI studio and MDM studio there. What we can do is Connectivity Studio is an integration solution. So not only we can do EDI, we can do data migrations with Connectivity Studio, and we can do interfacing. A lot of our customers, for instance, interface with a PLM system to import products from their PLM system into Dynamics 365. But there are also other connections available, like trade agreements. I want to import all the trade agreements for a vendor, or I want to share data across companies. Maybe the master data that customer needs to be shared over 50 customers, different companies. And there are no virtual tables anymore in Dynamics 365, but still I want to have the same customer in all those other 50 customers, companies. And then I want to use master data management to share the data across in a manageable way. But Master Data Studio can also be used for vendors, for those trade agreements, what you can share, or maybe even parameter settings. Validations. If you want to do item validations or other validations, multiplicity, then that information should be, of course, at the broker or at the VEN. We do that inside the ERP system. Of course, the VEN is very good in validating the data itself. So if there are fields mandatory, are they populated? If an email address is sent over, is it in the correct format? Those kind of validations are very well at brokers, but if you want to do the master data validations on items, on vendor numbers, on barcode, etc., that is not always there, and then you need to have continuous synchronizations, and that's that copy function if you want to have that. And yeah, that's now all available in our system in the ERP. And of course, high performance. We have all kinds of benchmark that we can pretty quickly import data and export data. The Connectivity Studio element, where Jerry will take over to give you a short introduction about that.
Yes, thank you very much, Eric. Indeed, Connectivity Studio is a very important part of the whole solution, doing the communication with either the broker or your customers and vendors directly, or a mix of that. And what we try to achieve is enable you to handle and manage and set up that yourself, and also do integrations with other systems. So added value there. And the power of our integration solutions is bringing that integration part closer to business. As you know, the business knows how systems work together, how you work together with a customer, or how you would like to work together with a customer. And you can explain the best how it should work. So, but in practice, if an integration needs to be made, we need a lot of technical information or a lot of technical knowledge to do that. So normally the business explains to IT department how things should work. IT department translates that into technical needs and discusses that probably with a partner consultant who will write down what is needed, and he will hand that over to a developer who is, as you can see, far away from the business and doesn't have that holistic view of the business and what the exact details are. And details are always the most important part in EDI and integrations. So he will set up with the information he knows, with the Microsoft tools, he will develop something and then deliver it back for testing. And then it seems things are missing and we get different iterations before it is all working. Wouldn't it be nice if a partner consultant, because you can configure everything, could already set up things, or even the IT department, or the partner could hand over to the IT department after the first setup and they do the testing and rework. So the power of our business integration solutions is all about configuration, that we deliver a lot of templates for integrations and EDI messaging. So make it easy. That is what we try to achieve. And then in Connectivity Studio, there are some basics just for mapping And Eric can explain you exactly how that works, and we'll show you through some slides.
Yes, indeed. So there are some basics for our mapping. Before I want to go there, I just wanted to show you one screen again. You saw that I was running, for instance, for my confirmation, those messages. Jerry mentioned there are some templates. These are a subset of all the templates that we have within the system for Connectivity Studio. And this is, of course, the EDI part where you see several sales messages, and in this case also for our purchase site, several purchase messages. Now, indeed, the basics, how do you set up those messages? That I want to explain to you now. So we have always a source, and we have a target. And in between the source and the target, we have a mapping. Now, the source and the target will also determine what you are doing. Will you do an import or will you do an export? So if Dynamics 365 is on the target side, then we talk about an import. But if it's on the source side, then we talk about an export, of course. And maybe what you want to do is go from one legal entity in Dynamics to another legal entity. And then, of course, that is a possibility where we make use of in master data management. But in this case, I'm talking about an import. And I'm getting data from a CRM system, and I want to send that customer information into Dynamics 365. And for that, I'm using a message. Now, what are the building blocks to do that? Documents. We have a document on the source side. And in that document, you describe the information of how you get it presented. And it could be a file, could also be an ODBC connection. But then in the document, you tell, okay, what are the different records? What are the different tables? And what are the fields that are, and what is the format of what I'm receiving? In the AX side, there we have also a document. There I, of course, describe what tables do I import into, or maybe views, or maybe something else. And yeah, correctly mentioned, we are able to import into tables directly. We don't need entities. We can import in entities, of course, not a problem. But if we want to update one field, or maybe update multiple tables at the same time, where I have to have a group of entities, then it's already a little bit more difficult. And then I can, but in our document, we can specify all those tables, and we can import into that directly. Also, we can import into tables that are non-standard Dynamics tables. So if you create a table inside Dynamics 365 with some custom fields, it will automatically be available in our system. But these are the basics. So, and in between the documents, those two documents on the target and the source sides, you will do the mapping. Now let's go into a little bit more detail on the source document. In that source document, what do I find there? I will find the record again, and all the different fields. These fields can be initialized, for instance, from a text file. In this case, it is a text document, which is pipe separated. We support all the different separators. Even if you have a separator that consists of multiple characters, so it could be pipe, semicolon, or all kinds of different elements, we can support. And in my document itself, you can either initialize or create all the different field names that are present, in this case, column names that are present in that document. In case of ODBC, of course, you want to describe the different fields that are present in the table via from the database that is connected via ODBC to our system. Then the target document describing what we use on the import side. So I describe the different tables in AX there. In this case, of course, for the customer, I have multiple tables. I have to have the customer table, but I also have a relation between the customer table and all the name and address information that you have in the that's connected via the dear organization. So we also describe the different relations. We can also import directly into a view, and that's what you see here. The postal address for you is actually a combination of three tables. But to keep it a little bit more simple, we can also import into that view, and then the system will automatically get the data to the correct tables. So this is what I want to import. This is the information, and on the right you will see the different fields where I want to get the data into. On the message, I will do the mapping, where I will select my source record. In this case, it's all the same record, but of course it can, if you have an XML file, it can, and other files, it can have multiple records in there. So it could also be a very complex document. But there I map the source record to the different target records, and you can see that I can reuse different views. So for instance, if you want to import different email addresses, phones, fax information, then you can use multiple of the same tables, but then of course with different constant values. Constant values, that's something that I can specify in my mapping. In the mapping on the right, you will see how I can connect the target field to the source field and how I do that. But there are also other elements available like that constant value, but maybe I want to do transformation. Maybe I want to do a conversion. What is a transformation? From one country code, for instance, to another country code, or from one customer value to another customer value. Things like that you can transform. And what's a conversion? Telling the system, okay, what is the date format? How is it formatted? Is it year, month, day, or different elements can be configured there. You see also a button company specific. If you want to import or do an integration to many companies at the same time, many legal entities in Dynamics, then I can also, that can also be handled. I see somebody took over my share. So let's start sharing again. Here we go. Then this mapping, can it be done easier or easy? Because of course we can map it manually. Yeah, we also have the capability of do form mapping, where we have the source fields that we need, and we can, by simply selecting the plus signs, to do the mapping of the target fields. And then you do that just on an AX form, as you see here. This is the customer form, and if I want to map the customer group for my source field to this field in DAX, then I simply press the plus button. And so I can go through all the different source fields and by selecting plus how to map it. And if there are different tables available on that form, because that's happening, okay, the system will take care of that as well. And then of course history. Everything that we do, exports and imports, will have history. And if something goes wrong, we can solve that where we see there's an error status, and then we can see, okay, why was there error status there, and what happened. And that's of course very useful when you start doing your test runs, but also later if you are having all kinds of integrations going on when something goes wrong. And it could be that in a message that's going to be delivered, a certain field is not existing, and therefore we get that error. But full history and very detailed history. And now I'd like to switch back to Jerry to give you the summary.
Thank you, Eric, for showing us Connectivity Studio, which is an important part of the whole EDI solution, and shows you it's a multi-purpose solution, not only for EDI, focused on business user integrated information and can maintain it themselves, but also for IT and tool where they can manage integrations in the broader sense with systems and in this in EDI case with brokers and directs to customers. So summarizing, EDI Studio is looking at what is happening in Dynamics 365 And based on what's happening, it's creating events based on the setup, which customer will receive what. With Connectivity Studio, an ED Factor, X12, or whatever format will be created and sent to the vendor or the customer. But I must say, 90% of our customers use the way through a broker. So these events will all fire in case of a purchase order, the same XML that has all data that all these vendors would like to have. And the broker does the mapping towards the right format and the right data for that specific vendor. So splitting it up and mapping it. They already have a lot of these ready because more companies are using them, and they have vendor A already in their mapped list. So they can do it quicker. And that's where we see this combination between direct and indirect. And we work also together with a lot of these brokers. And one of these examples is Tykinetics, where we have a total end-to-end proposition for end customers, where they have also a platform called Flow, not to be mistaken by Microsoft Flow, but Flow from Tykinetics, also a Microsoft Azure like Dynamics 365, with our business integration solutions inside. They will consume the XMLs that are set up already from within Dynamics 365, and they split to the ED Factor or X12 documents that your customers want. But I also have a strong platform on the non-EDI part. So, and this is how customers could maybe take a big part of their business also digital, instead of just a few of their customers or vendors that want to communicate through EDI. So make digital communication for all your customers. So that's altogether how we want to achieve this ideal situation where business users have an integrated information to take fast decisions and make decisions well with a single point of truth and have it integrated. And IT people having created a solution where users, business users are self-sufficient and they can focus on the technical parts as IT people can have an easy and flexible tool that is multi-purpose. And they can also be choosing different brokers, maybe even with big international companies, we see also they have different brokers in different areas. So with Connectivity Studios, you could have different brokers and all their own XML messages. So in that sense, you're very flexible in choosing and having integrations. And we are not doing it just yesterday. We have like 600 customers at the moment using our business integration solutions for all these purposes that we discussed. And these are just a few examples. So that leaves us with 2 minutes for questions. And I only saw one question at the moment. So if you have questions, we can take them, of course, later as well. If you are interested, please get in touch with us through our website or through the information you find on the Microsoft Dynamics World. And Eric, can you handle the question from Todd?
Yeah, but I can't see it. Hopefully I can see it now. Yeah, got it. Yeah. Okay, the question from Todd is, how are the outbound purchase order acknowledged confirmations determined? The confirmation codes determined. And now my question is, what codes do you exactly mean? Is this a specific default code that you want to set up with the customer? Sorry.
Maybe we should take this question after the session. Yeah.
And then,
so the last question was, do you also handle stock updating message back from 3PL? Yes, we do.
Yes, we do that.
Yeah. And we have XML messages ready to take that. So altogether, it's 6 o'clock here where I am, but it's on the hour. Thank you very much for your attention. And the recording will be available as well later. Hopefully we get in touch soon. Have a great day.